إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد لقد قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد Indeed, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, we seek His forgiveness, and we seek His assistance and His help. And we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil within ourselves and the wickedness of our deeds. Whom save Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none is able to misguide. And whom save Allah misguides, none is able to guide. And I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. No partners has He. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His final messenger sent unto all mankind. O Allah, we ask Thee to bestow Thy choicest blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and all those who follow his way until the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us in the Quran, O you who believe, be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with correct awareness and awe-inspired awareness, and die not except in a state of total submission unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, one of the chapters that we are all encouraged to recite on the day of Yawmul Jumu'ah is the chapter known as Surah Al-Kahf, which is the 18th chapter in the Quran. And it is within this particular really amazing an enlightening surah of the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets forth a parable, a mithal, an example for all of us to reflect upon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم in verse number 32. وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ Allah says, present to them. Meaning present to the people. مَثَلَ الرَّجُلَيْنِ So we done رَجُل? رَجُلَيْنِ The example of two men. جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنِ We gave to one of the two men جَنَّتَيْنِ Two jannas. But we're not talking about jannah as in terms of paradise now. Now we are talking about two gardens. So jannah, we will interpret jannah as being what we know, jannah. Paradise, heaven. But in this example, Jannataini means two gardens. Min a'nabin. Two gardens of grapes. So basically a grape orchid or grape vine. Wahafafnahuma binakhlin. And we allowed the grape vines, the grape orchid, to be surrounded, to be encompassed by nakhl. Nakhl? What is nakhl? Nakhl is the date palm trees. Now remember, nahl with a ha, noon ha lam, this refers to the bee. Noon ha lam refers to the palm trees. So just imagine, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the spectacle, the scene. Here we have two individuals. One of them has a particular and elaborate blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has two gardens. And the other man, he does not have any gardens. Then Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. And we placed between these two gardens land for cultivation. So basically, fertile land. Then Allah continues, كِلْتَ الْجَنَّتَيْنِ آتَتْ أُكُلَهَا. Meaning, and these two gardens, they yielded an abundance of produce, crops, fruits, vegetation, etc. Just imagine the scene, the joy, the elation that this would bring to this individual who owns these two gardens. وَلَمْ تَظْلِمْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. And this means there was no deficiency, meaning وَلَمْ تَنْقُسْ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. So there was no restriction, there was no deficiency to yield the best of produce. And Allah continues, وَفَجَّرْنَا خِلَالَهُمَا نَهَرًا. And we even caused, what is nahr? Can anyone know what is nahr?
River.
And we even caused a river to flow between the two gardens. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. وَكَانَ لَهُ, we haven't done كَانَ yet. كَانَ is one of the sisters. وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ. And this owner of these two gardens, he had an abundance of produce. And this is really an amazing, interesting thing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at this very point wants to point out to us. When this man, this owner of the gardens, said to his companion, فَقَالَ, and he said, لِصَاحِبِهِ. What is a sahib? When we think of sahaba, what is a sahaba?
Friend.
A friend, companion. فَقَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ, and he said to his companion, to his friend, okay? وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. A حِوَار is a dialogue, a conversation. Whilst conversing with him. Now if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had only said, فَقَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ, we would have understood exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant. When he was conversing with his, and he said to his companion, he said to his friend, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala added, وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. وَهُوَ, what is هُوَ? In Arabic? Huwa.
He.
Wahuwa yuhawiruhu, and he is conversing with his companion, with his friend. Now, a hiwar, a conversation as we know it, it is not like a speech. Which means whatever the man is about to say is not something which he has pre-planned, which has been dictated to him, or it is not something which he has thought about the hiwar. We're talking about the conversation now. It is more deeper than that. Basically, it is coming from the heart. So what is he telling his friend? He says to him, Ana. What is Ana? Aktharu. What is Aktharu? From Kathir. Kathir. What is Kathir? Kathir means a lot. Ana aktharu minka. Min, we done the word min. What is min?
From,
right? So minka.
You.
You. Ana aktharu minka malan wa a'azzu nafara. Meaning basically, I have more wealth. I am richer than you, I'm more wealthier than you, and I have a mightier group, clan, than yours. Right? Now, we look at the word ana. Look at the language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses here. The language of ana, the language of me, the language of I, the language of myself, is the language which Iblis used. What did he say? Ana khayrun minhu. When he was ordered to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, he said, Ana khayrun. So what does ana mean? I. What does khayr mean? Better minhu than him. See, you understand. Ana khayrun minhu. It was also the language of Fir'aun. When he said, وَنَادَى فِرْعَوْنُ فِي قَوْمِهِ قَالَ يَا قَوْمُ. And Fir'aun, he called out to his people. He proclaimed to his people. Right? And this again he said, وَنَادَى فِرْعَوْنُ فِي قَوْمِهِ. Meaning, he called out, Fir'aun called out to his people. He was amassing his people. What does he say? The declaration of myself or me. He says, أَلَيْسَ لِي مُلْكُ مِصْرِ. He says, أَلَيْسَ وِدَلْ أَهَذَا. Correct? Now, أَلَيْسَ here just means, isn't the kingdom of Egypt for me? Doesn't it belong to me? أَلَيْسَ لِي مُلْكُ مِصْرِ. And then he says, you must understand this now, وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي. We got Nahar. Nahar is, what was Nahar? River. Anhar is a plural. وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِي. Basically means, are not, or isn't this rivers flowing, tajri, beneath me? Meaning basically, am I not in control of it? أَفَلَا تُبُصِرُونَ. Do you then not perceive? Do you then not see? It was also the language of Qarun. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Qarun said, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. Which means, he said, all that I had been given is by the virtue of the knowledge. Ilm. عِنْدِي. وِدَىٰ عِنْدِي. The knowledge which I possess, which I have. This was Qarun. Now what does Allah say about him? وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ. And we granted him and we gave him مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ. Kunuz is treasure. Kanz. Have you heard of kanz, the word kanz? Think of cousin, but you can think kanz. Kanz, kunuz, treasure. He had treasures that their keys were so heavy. They were a heavy burden to a group, a brand, a band of strong men, meaning the keys to his treasures were so heavy. So what's it about the treasure? It took an army of men to carry the keys to open up the vault, whatever he had at that time. So his people who were witnessing this, they said to him, "Karun, take it easy, man. Take it easy." They said to him, "Wabtaghi fima ataaka Allahu ad-dar al-akhirah." Now I ask you, what is dar al-akhirah?
House of.
House of?
Yeah.
Or just the year after. Terminology, dar al-akhirah is the year after. Right? Rather seek by means of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, seek the year after therewith. Because Qarun was only thinking about the dunya. If you have money, it is a great thing. If you have a blessing, Allah has blessed you. MashaAllah, Alhamdulillah. It is a great blessing. But it depends on how you use that blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like when we have health, we have intelligence, we have money, and we have all the privileges. But it depends on how we use these ni'mat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this man, he had two gardens, but he did not recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing unto him in all of this. Because he said, the means have caused, he said to his friend, the means has caused that I am better than you. Because I have much more than you. Allah continues and says in the next verse, you must be able to understand this as well. وَدَخَلَ, what is دَخَلَ? We done خَرَجَ and we done دَخَلَ. What is دَخَلَ? To? To enter. Yes. وَدَخَلَ and he entered جَنَّتَهُ. So he entered his? See? MashaAllah. وَدَخَلَ جَنَّتَهُ and he entered his garden. Now entering a place is very significant. And it is like Qarun in the Quran. Whenever Qarun said these things, it was a verbal triumph. He verbalized his power, his prestige, uttering it. But in the next verse after that, it actually becomes actualized. In Qarun's example, he says, all that I possess is by the virtue of my knowledge which I possess. Sadly to say, this could be said, some people might say, whatever I have, maybe you've heard people say this, is because of my own intelligence. Or they might say, my own hard work. Or they might say, I invested my money 50 years ago and now I'm seeing the rewards thereof. The fruits thereof. Where is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the equation in all of this? Is it just about you? The man with the two gardens, he had the same mindset. He had the same understanding. Now we come again to another verse. وَدَخَلَ جَنَّتَهُ and he entered his garden. وَهُوَ and he ظَالِمٌ. What is a ظَالِم?
ظَالِم.
A ظَالِم is an oppressor, but it can also be used as he was unjust. وَهُوَ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ, meaning he was unjust to himself. Okay? and he was a wrongdoer upon himself. So how can you be unjust to yourself? I'll give you explanation. It means ظَلَمَ أَقْلَهُ, which means he wronged his intelligence. Now someone might ask, how does a person wrong his intelligence? So remember, ظَلَمَ أَقْلَهُ. أَقْل is the intelligence, is the mind, is the brain. Right? And ظَلَمَ نَفْسَهُ, and he wronged himself. So the wording that I'm going to use in Arabic now, we will explain to you. وَأَيُّ ظُلْمٍ أَشَدُّ مِنْ أَنْ تَوَهَّمَ نَفْسَكَ بِشَيْءٍ أَنْتَ بَعِيدٌ وِدَنْ بَعِيدٌ وِدَنْ أَنْتَ عَنْهُ. So basically, what does this mean? Which injustice is worse for a man to think that he is something, but yet he is the furthest, ba'id, huwa ba'idun anhu, he is the furthest from that thing. So I repeat that. Which injustice is worse for a man to think that he is something? He think he is great, he think he is good, but he is the furthest from that thing. How did he make dhulam of his nafs, of his own self? ظلم نفسه حينما أشرك الأسباب مع الله. He did harm to his nafs, to his soul, to himself, when he associated partners, أشرك, shirk, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he made the means his goal. He wronged himself when he associated partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by making the means his goal. It was not the fact that he had been blessed with two gardens. That was not the problem. It was the fact that he could not see the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who had granted him firstly the gardens. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was al-mun'im, which is the one who provided the blessings for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-fa'al. Allah is the one who did that. Fa'al, from fi'al, the doer. Allah is the one who granted that for him. But this man was so consumed within himself, so he could not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of this. And this is sadly one of the predicaments of the times or the age that we are living in, called self-consumption. Okay? Self-consumption. Seeing that it is about you and your happiness. So I'll give an example. Just imagine if a child watches or is exposed to an average amount of television per day, and he is bombarded with commercials, with adverts, each one selling him the idea that your happiness lies in your consumption. The more you consume, the happier you will be. And if you cannot consume, you will wallow over in despair and in self-misery. So what we do is that with these advertisements and commercials, we then start to focus on buying. And the whole essence of life becomes about acquiring and buying things, because we believe that happiness lies in those things. And so we spend money which we don't actually have on things that we don't actually need. So the man who entered the garden and he had wronged himself and he had said to his friend, أَنَا أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ مَالًا, I have more wealth than you, and I have a mightier clan than yours. He did ظَلَمَ نَفْسًا, he did an injustice to himself. Coupled with that, he says, the verse continues, قَالَ مَا أَذُنُّ أَن تَبِيدَ هَذِهِ أَبَدًا. What is أَبَدًا?
Forever.
So right, something to do with forever. So he says, whatever I have is like a blanketing experience. It is all surrounding, a cushioning and comforting experience. So when he says, قَالَ مَا أَذُنُّ, I don't think that this garden will ever perish. So he says to his companion, I don't think that this garden that I have will ever perish. I don't think that this garden which I have is ever going to leave me. I think whatever enjoyment I have now is here forever. And we will say, yes, it has to be that way because he has not seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in anything. He's only seen himself and he has made the means the end. Then he also says to his companion, وَمَا أَذُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمًا. وَمَا, and I do not, أَذُنُّ ظَن, basically, is to think or believe. وَمَا أَذُنُّ, so I do not believe. What is سَاعَة? What is سَاعَة? You will say time, سَاعَة, right? So what do we refer into time here?
The hour.
So he says, nor do I believe that the hour of judgment will take place, will convene, ever convene. So, qa'ima, right? وَلَا إِرُّدِدْتُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي. Now, إِلَىٰ رَبِّي. What does إِلَىٰ رَبِّي mean? To? Rabbi. To my Lord. So he says, nor do I believe, or he says, وَلَا إِرُّدِدْتُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي, and even if I'm returned, from رَدَّ يَرُدُّ means to return, إِلَىٰ رَبِّي, even if I'm returned to my Lord, لَأَجِدَنَّ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا مُنْقَلَبًا. He says, I will find even a better place than this that I have. Then his friend, who had been listening to the conversation, to this hiwar, says to him, in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his friend says, قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ, and his friend said to him, وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. So this is not now the owner, this is the poor man, says to him. And he's conversing with him. Akafarta, from the word kufr. Kufr means to deny, to reject. Right? Akafarta billadhi khalaqaka. Khalaqa means, when Allah says, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaqa al-insana min alaq. Allah says, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ, he who created mankind, مِنْ عَلَقْ. Right, so here, the word خَلَقَكَ, مِنْ تُرَابٍ, تُرَاب, dust, soil. ثُمَّ مِنْ نُطَفَةٍ, ثُمَّ سَوَّاكَ رَجُلًا. So his companion replies and says to him, أَكَفَرْتَ, do you disbelieve in the one who had created you? From what? From dust, from soil, turab. Thumma min nutfa, and then from a liquid, semen, sperm. ثُمَّ سَوَّاكَ and then fashioned you into a perfect man. So it's fantastic like this. Then he continues and says, لَكِنَّ هُوَ اللَّهُ رَبِّي لَكِنَّ هُوَ اللَّهُ رَبِّي. You must be able to understand هُوَ اللَّهُ رَبِّي, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my Rabb. لَكِنَّ in Arabic means but. But as for me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my Lord. وَلَا أُشْرِكُ بِرَبِّي أَحَدًا. And I do not make shirk, do not associate anyone in worship with my Lord. Then he says, Allah says further in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. So he says to him, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ, if only you had entered your garden and you had said, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ, basically meaning, MashaAllah, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there is no might and no power except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we're going to come. What does saying MashaAllah la quwwata illa do? Have you thought about this? What does the saying MashaAllah la quwwata illa billah do? It destroys a culture of envy, of hasad. So when someone gets a new car or anything new, whatever house, the first thing you should say is MashaAllah, to destroy the hasad. You see, if you project yourself in the world as successful and successful on account of yourself, because of you, and the person besides you does not have what you have, nor has he achieved what you have achieved, it is obviously going to generate a culture of envy. But if you say, no, whatever I have is not from me, MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah, whatever I have is not from me, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a very, very important thing, brothers and sisters in Islam, that we understand this concept of MashaAllah la quwwata illa billah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes further and says, إِن تَرَنِ أَنَا أَقَلَّ مِنْكَ مَالًا وَوَلَدًا فَعَسَى رَبِّي أَن يُؤْتِيَنِ خَيْرًا مِنْ جَنَّتِكَ وَيُرْسِلَ عَلَيْهَا حُسْبَانًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَتُصْبِحَ صَعِيدًا زَلَقًا أَوْ يُصْبِحَ مَاؤُهَا غَوْرًا فَلَنْ تَسْتَطِيعَ لَهُ طَلَبًا. Allah says, إِن تَرَنِي, تَرَى means to see. So if you see me, أَنَا أَقَلَّ, أَنَا again, I قَلَّ from قَلِيل, قَلِيل means a little, مِنْ كَمَالًا meaning if you see me poorer, less fortunate, destitute than minka, than yourself, in terms of wealth, money, wawalada, and children. And then he says to him that it could be maybe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants me a garden better than your God. Maybe in the future. As for you, whatever you have, on the other hand, could come to ruins. Yes. This could happen as well. But for a man who is so self-consumed and does not see that the world is going to come to an end, and so this is exactly what happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down thunderbolts in the form of rain, right, from the sky, turning that fertile, cultivated, and the land that was producing the best of crops and produce, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned it into a barren wasteland. Or its water may dry up. Yes. Water can come to an end because the rivers were flowing there. And you will never be able to find the source. Then Allah says, وَأُحِيطَ بِثَمَرِ فَأَصْبَحَ يُقَلِّبُ كَفَّيْهِ. كَفَّي in Arabic, kaf is also another word for yad, which is hand. كَفَّي means his two hands. عَلَى مَا أَنْفَقَ فِيهَا. Allah says, it so happened that all his fruit produce was destroyed, and the vines came tumbling down upon their trellises. So he wrung his fingers in grief for all that he had invested, anfaqa, nafaqa, that he had spent on it of time, of wealth, etc., etc. So we, my brothers and sisters in Islam, we can learn a very profound lesson in these verses in Surah Al-Kahf about individualism, about ourselves, about responsibility, that in our world today, Allah has expectations from us. Allah has expectations for us, and we should be doing certain things. And we will not be able to do those things if we are self-consumed within ourselves. The same, of course, applies to all these examples which we use in the Quran of Qarun, Fir'aun, the men of the gardens. The examples are all the same. They wronged themselves. And they wronged others. Why? Because they did not have, or they could not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their lives. They could only see the means as a way for their happiness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us our strength. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us guidance. And that we can find in everything we do in our lives, we find Allah. Whether you are a billionaire, millionaire, trillionaire, or if you have nothing, because we take a principle, a qa'ida. Qa'ida in Arabic, a principle from these verses. I'm going to read this qa'ida to you. Anna kathrat al-mal la tadul ala rida Allah. Meaning that if you have a lots and lots of money, لا تدل, it is not an indication that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with you. Then, وَأَنَّ قِلَّةَ الْمَالِ لَا تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ سَخَةِ اللَّهِ. And that having a little or less money does not indicate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry or Allah is displeased with you. فَالْأُمُورُ, the affairs, umur, لَا تُوزَنُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بِالْأُمُورِ الْمَاضِيَةِ, which basically means Allah does not judge you by the material affairs of this life. Allah does not judge you by the material affairs of this life. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you, it is a blessing which requires you to be patient and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But not to think that because of what I have, I must be the best, better than my neighbor, better than everyone else. No. And nor should the man who does not have, he should not think that because I don't have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased or angry with me. No, it does not work like this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us His forgiveness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us His rahmah, encompass us with His rahmah, with His mercy. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq, inshaAllah ta'ala. Which end of what a dua, inshaAllah ta'ala. Al-Fatiha. اللهم لك الحمد كله ولك الشكر كله وإليك يرجع الأمر كله على نيته وسره فأهلنا أنت أن تحمد وأهلنا أنت أن تعبد وأنت على كل شيء قدير اللهم لك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا اللهم لك الحمد بالإسلام ولك الحمد بالإيمان ولك الحمد بالقرآن ولك الحمد بالمال والأهل والمعافات اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين اللهم إنا نسألك بأنك أنت الله لا إله إلا أنت الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وصفاتك العليا أن تغفر لنا وترحمنا يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وأطراف النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر لنا اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا ولوالدينا ولأزواجنا ولأولادنا ولمشايخنا ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة ونعيمها وما يقربنا إليها من قول أو عمل ونعوذ بك من النار ونعوذ بك من النار ونعوذ بك من النار وما يقربنا إليها من قول أو عمل اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى يا رب العالمين اللهم يا ساتر الحال لا تكشف الحال وبارك لنا في المال والأهل والعيال اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين وانصر عبادك الموحدين اللهم انصر إخواننا المجاهدين والمستضعفين والمظلومين في كل مكان اللهم أيدهم بنصر من عندك يا رب العالمين اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت ولي ومولاها يا رب العالمين اللهم يا رب الناس أذهب البأس أنت الشافي لا شفاء إلا شفاؤك شفاؤك لا يغادر سقما وألما نسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيهم شفاء كاملا عاجلا يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر لأهل القبور من المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات ارفع لهم الدرجات وكفر عنهم السيئات يا رب العالمين اللهم تقبل صلاتنا وقيامنا وركوعنا وسجودنا وتسبيحنا ودعاءنا يا رب العالمين قال الله تعالى مخبرا وآمرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم بفضلك دعواهم فيها سبحانك اللهم وتحيتهم فيها سلام وآخر دعواهم أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
قبل الله إن شاء الله.